simply overwhelmed and do not know how I can. I have to thank so many people, but as you know, my time is up. And so, but at least there are 2-3 people, or let us say our own department of South and Southeast Asian Studies, course, Chair Amy Edwards, Sender people, Cohen, and all the ladies there. And in our own department, one more person whose name must be mentioned, because she is the one who helped to make all the so-called, there is a word for that, PowerPoint. And Nancy Lichtenstein, very obligingly. And she did it during her lunch break. I mentioned it because the office doesn't like people making a work this way. But in any case, without dwelling too much on the wonderful affection shown here and all the great scholars who have come here with whom I had years of experience, I thought that for this occasion, I will take you home, my own home. And before I do that, let me start with the explaining what I'm going to talk about. Now you said I have to press this in order to, yeah, you have got that, let me explain it here. Every word is significant. A South Indian Jain Rath Yatra at Nellikar in Thirunadu. South Indian, that means what you are going to see now, it doesn't happen in North India at all. But in South India also, it is restricted to Thirunadu and maybe neighborhood. There may be that this was a practice all over India once upon a time among the Jains and Buddhists and others also. But it is now famous in Orissa, where the Jagannath, that's Jagannath, the Ratha is there. But the Jaina temple, Ratha Yatra, you see now, is restricted to Nellikar, that's a small village where I was born. And for I was born, but now that you know my age now, 23, and around 8 or 9 years old, my father sent me away, all the way near Nagpur area, to go to a Jaina Gurukul to study. So what I had seen during those early 5 years, 7 years, that is the annual Rath Yatra, which has made such an impression on me, the scenery of that, and the drama of that, and the music of that, and the arati, and the abhishek, everything. So I thought, why not talk about that? In 1980, with Junior Jaini, my son here, our son, we are first time you are attending your dad's lecture. He expressed a wish that he would like to, and I wanted him to see this theatre taking place in the first week of March, and it happens on the Yugadi, that's the first day of the new year of the Shakar era. Shalivar Shakar is celebrated all over South India, but in the north it is Vikram Samvat. So Jains also have the Shakar and the Yugadi, that's the beginning of the new year, and that's the time when this particular takes place. And when he, in 1980, we visited, a few pictures were taken of that, and those pictures I am going to show you today, which actually happened there, ritual. And the main point is, research point is coming after you see the pictures. In the meantime, the person whom you are going to hear in the afternoon, but Peter Fugel from SOS, I might say he is my successor there, everyone, but he has established the Jaina Center, and within a few years he has achieved more than people achieving an entire career. So, he was going to Tulu Nadu, that Nadu is the Tulu Nadu, it's not a state, it's a small district. But the spoken language is Tulu, and only in that area Tulu is spoken. Only 1 million people speak Tulu. As I was making a joke yesterday, you could call me 1 in 1 million. Let me move to the subject now without too much in mind. He went to various parts of Shravanbelagola downwards, Kuncha, etc., which he is going to talk this afternoon. And then he came to Mudbidri, where he said the 18 temples, Siddhanta Granthas, Bhattara Kasid, and almost several people, Bob and Sally have been to Mudbidri, and John has been there, Peter has been there, so many others also have, Paul has been there. So I would say that those who have been there, they would know what kind of scenery to expect, coconut trees and cactus, and it's a very beautiful, lush place, except it's very hot. And in the temple, when you have to go around, you can't wear shoes or socks, it's very hot. You literally walk on your toes. But let me further now go further on. So Peter, I'm sorry, that's what I was talking about. Peter's, I asked him, you should go to Nellikar, which is only about 10-15 miles away from Mudbidri, and therefore, in his own research interest, he went there and he has taken some fascinating pictures. So he was going to talk on Nellikar today, but then he's going to talk on something even better, the Kuncha is talking in the afternoon, and that's where the Bhattara Granthi is there also. He allowed me to use these pictures, and that's where I will start. So let me first start with the next one. There's a map there for you to show. You know where it is. Mangalore is not too far here, I think it's somewhere. There's just this above Kerala right here, and just this part, Kuncha and all that, within 3 hours, 4 hours drive. Shravanbelagola is here, and this is the way, this is where Jainism was concentrated. A little further if you go, Ashokan inscriptions have been found there. Not one, two, five inscriptions have been found nearby there. So already Ashoka's time, 230 BC, 260 BC, Greek Jainism might have come little earlier, according to Jain Chandragupta Maurya came, etc. And then he came where? He came to this Shravanbelagola. And this Shravanbelagola has a colossal Bahubali image. From there then, Jainism may be spread here to the coastal areas. And this is the coastal area, Bombay, Goa and Mangalore. So, from there then, that map I have shown you, from there we move to the next one. You see this Bahubali? This is the Shravanbelagola Bahubali. And this Shravanbelagola Bahubali is 981. And this was the image, not taken from somewhere and placed there. It's almost 55 feet, and almost many Jains have gone there and have seen this. It was cut into the standing rock. The peak itself is turned into an image. It is not brought from somewhere or assembled together, or it's not part. It's a cut. It's like a huge peak was itself cut and leveled ground. And this is the way 60-foot, a single. And this was done by a minister of that time of a Jaina kingdom, Ganga Rajya, and his minister is Chamunda Raya, and he's at the feet of this image. Inscriptions appear in three languages, in Tamil, in Kannada, and in Marathi. The first Marathi inscription, Chamunda Raya Karaviyalen, and Tamil and Kannada, and no name of a Acharya who made the Pratishtha, let alone the artist who carved this beautiful one. And every 12 years, they will put a thing there, and then the most important thing happens is the consecration. That's the word for that. Abhisheka. Maham is the great, because it's every 12th year. Mastakam is the head. Abhisheka means you go up. Otherwise, every day you have to pour water only on the feet, because you can just see that, how tall the image is. But 12th year, they can go upstairs, people are there, they climb and then pour milk or whatever. Consecration is the about which we have already heard earlier, and that consecration takes place, and people will go there taking the pitchers of water and so on and so forth. So this ceremony and the ritual abhishek is central to Jaina rituals, which we are going to talk about. The Shvetambaras have the word for that, snatra, those who are using similar things. But the abhisheka, of course, abhisheka is a very Hindu, Buddhist, Jain term, so many meanings are attached to that. But basically, it is anointing an image or even anointing a king, like a prince as a king, that's a patta abhisheka, etc. Use the word. So, this particular religion, the cult, the ritual and everything, and the priests that are going to be, I'm talking about the priests mostly today, and these priests are also probably spreading from here, from 981. And we come now to the next one, will be, see now, now we come to Tulu Nadu. In Tulu Nadu, there were at least five chieftains. They call themselves Rajas, but chieftains these are. And they are Jains, and they had established temples, so many. But this one, in a place called Karkala, which is only 10 miles away from the village where Nellikar is there. You can see now a copy of that, and that happened where in 1432. And this was done by King Veera Pandya, Bhairava, and that is the image of Bahubali, which you have listened. Now this Bahubali, who is that? He is Bahubali, is not a Tirthankara. Like the 24 Tirthankaras was venerated for teaching, etc. Bahubali is the, according to the Digambara Jains, that means those images are without any clothes whatsoever. And this is the way declaring renunciation total. The first person to have achieved moksha during this time cycle is Bahubali. He was a great wrestler also, he was a great Kamadeva also, and he has, just a few minutes to explain who he is for. He is the son of the first Tirthankara Rishabha, he is the brother, younger brother of the first Chakravartin called Bharata, and the Jains say that because of this Bharata, the India was called Bharata. There are several Bharatas, but this is one Jaina story. This Bharata has assumed the role of the first Chakravarti, means the universal monarchy has conquered the whole world. And then he asked Bahubali, his name is never given, he's just Bahubali. That's probably that's a title given to him. He asked his younger brother to submit to him, saying that now you come and accept me as your overlord. And Bahubali says, no, I won't. Why should I? Our father became a Jina and now you have become a king. Let us have a wrestling or some such match and find out who is king, etc. So the ministers said, all right, you can have a wrestling match instead of warfare. And Bahubali lifts his brother, younger brother up, and he's going to drop him down, and he suddenly realizes, what am I doing this? And so, that's the beginning of saying that I do not want this kingdom, I don't want this. And so he walks away from Bharata's place, you know, goes to some place like this, and there he stands in meditation in the Digambara way, as having taken the Mahavratas of the great vows of a monk by himself. And he stands there in the typical characteristic Jaina portion called Kayotsarga, Kausarga, abandonment of body, totally. And this is the one posture which is Jaina posture only. No other Indian saint or even Buddha standing in meditation like that is shown. They might have done that, but art form, Kausarga, only Jaina images are shown. And then years go and creepers grow around his arm, and so you can see on his arm going up here, as well as the snakes move around his feet. So this is shown and only after several years Bharata comes to him, and his sisters also who have become Brahmi, Sundari, they remove all the creepers etc. and creeper on, and then he is, they see him there standing in meditation, but he still has that inside feeling, I am still standing on Bharata's land. And because of that particular one thing, he cannot cross over. And that's where Bharata comes and says something. And then Bahubali becomes suddenly enlightened, actually. The stories are infinitely varied. This particular Bahubali took such fascination, people had such fascination for him, that within certain, as I said now, 1400-1500 years' time, we have got here another Bahubali, 40 feet one stone. And this was carried all the way from bottom, and it's a huge hill, stone only. This is not a bread of grass, it's entirely, it's entire, this whole building like a stone, not only building, whole campus actually, that kind of hill. It's a black stone. That's why Karkal means or Kari Kallu. Kari means black and Kallu means stone. So it's just rock. And so this was. Now let me say one word for about this pillar also, because I am going to talk about that a little later. In front of a jina, you have got Samavasarana, you heard earlier. There is Manastamba, Digambaras have Manastamba, it's a pillar of fame, some such word is used. Or when you look at it, your mana or garva goes away. So, Tirthankaras have only, Bahubali is not a Tirthankara. He just first to achieve, therefore he is venerated. And so there is a pillar is put, and on the pillar there is a Yaksha image of Kubera. Kubera image is Yaksha image in general, and so it is seated there. And this is called by the local people, as well as by tradition, as Brahma Yaksha. Now that's something which we have to talk about. Brahma Yaksha, there is no such thing as a Brahma Yaksha. There is one, Parshitala Natha, Tirthankara. But otherwise not like Padmavati and Dharanendra or some such similar ones, Kushmandini, Devi or some other deva. There is no such, we now understand, much research has been done by Hampana and other scholars, that Chamundaraya, who had that image in Shravanabelgola, he was a Brahma Kshatra, which means really a joining of the Brahmin and Kshatriya past. And he was born from that. And the Brahma Deva is called. And he had put a Brahma Deva there in Shravanabelgola. And those who came as his own, what you call the domestic deity, Griha Devata kind of thing. This is a guess, this is only speculation, but the word Brahma is there. And so those who start put the Gomat here, they also put a Brahma Deva there. But in Tulu Nadu, this Brahma Deva takes a new shape, and that is riding on horse. For the first time, riding on horse and coming through a forest kind of thing. And it is this Brahmadeva which will become a very major cult. And this, from this we move further. So see now, in a short place, within 30 miles, from Karkala to Nellikar, and then Venur, image of Bahubali at Venur, 1604. Venur is another 16 miles, or no more than 20 miles from Nellikar. So you have got within 30 miles, two colossal images like this Bahubali, and both are seats of chieftains. This is called, these are the Ajira, is the name of the household. Their descendants are still there, attached to their palace nearby, etc. And Karkala Vamsha is gone. But shows that how a small community would have had so resources to do this kind of thing within 30 miles, this happened. So now we probably are closer to next one. See now, these are, you please read that photograph by Peter Fugel. That's the courtesy because of which, say this is Nellikar from a distance as you walk from the Karkala Venur road going. There was only bullock cart, motor. This road is simply made now only. One had to go from the back area. But so you are approaching Nellikar. You can see all the this Deligarh is distinguished by the fact that this is the only place which exclusively Jain. There is not a single non-Jain in this. Among the Jain, there are two sub-jatis, let us say. One are called the Shettis. Setia. Set. Similar to that. And these are mostly merchants, money changers, and so on and so forth. Money lenders, landlords.
Are they from the Chettiar community?
Well, they are Jains. But because they are in this profession, they are called Shettis. Hmm. Because already there are Jains there. This was all created by Jains, non-Shettis. But Shettis have come, so there is a group of people who are simply, they are Jains, but they are Shettis, and probably they have come with the, well, people marching down for the business sake, etc. So this is a town of Shettis only. That's another distinguishing part. My barber had to come about 3-4 miles away. Within 3 miles, there is not a single Jain household or even Brahmin household. There may be some here and there farmers, but otherwise, the big person who was considered the head of this whole establishment, the temple that is, which I am going to show you, is about 4 miles. You have to walk and then go down like the Balinese rice fields. And that is where he has this place, and he used to be the head of this establishment. So now we are proceeding slowly, and now this is of course last year only, 1912. Now that road, see, these are the houses, and the cars can come. In my days there was no such facility, and so we move to the still next one. That leads you to a hill now, which you are going to climb, and this is the temple steps now. These are the, that's the long thing you saw, that was the marketplace, let us say. It is called Pete, the marketplace. And so we are now moving up the hill. And this will bring you to the temple. Now this is the temple. You see this? Up on, yeah. Am I saying the correct thing? Yeah, that's right. Can you see this? This is the temple inside, on the hill now, top, small hill, and the temple wall, the front part, and behind, houses are there around the temple. And this is the priest. And see, that's the temple leading to the inside now, and he is waiting there to be, Peter was fortunate to get a letter from the Bhattaraka, what were they saying, that please help this gentleman, he is going to help. So he was able to take the photographs also because of that. Now, this priest is called in Thudunadu only, or adjoining areas, Indra. Nowhere else is called, and I am going to talk about this priesthood, etc. By the way, let me say, there are Jains who do not believe in temple going at all. They don't. They have given up temple going, say from 1600, something like that. And they are not a majority, but there are a significant number of them present right here. I'm not asking you to lift your hands. I'm saying to say that Jains are not only those whom we are going to see now. There are other Jains, and already you have heard from Paul how the images are decorated, etc. That's another group of Jainism. They are populous, more populous, in both having numbers of ascetics as well as temples, etc. So you have got those whose images are not decorated at all, standing. Without or sitting, without any ornament whatsoever, and others which earlier shop Paul was showing how you have got the crown and all that. That's another one. And those who neither, no temple, let alone images. So I'm just showing you. You must have a balanced view now here, so you don't know how much they are missing. So this Indra am going to talk why, why is it called Indra. Indra, of course, is the king of the gods. And when the Tirthankara is born, as you heard earlier, when the Tirthankara is born, the Kalyana class, etc., half gods come down, and the Jains don't worship these gods. Not a single god, Indra, comes down, or no, he's not worshipped. He's like a guest. How? So in his absence, when they perform some special ceremonies, the Jains themselves become Indras. And wife becomes Indrani. You have to pay heavy money for that. They put a crown and all that, and then people will think that this is Indra, this is Indra, and they are taken into process. It's all a drama in a way. But the gods of the heaven are not worshipped at all. There is no image of Indra somewhere saying, okay, we will know. But the images of the yakshas, the guardian deities, Padmavati, Devi, and Dharmendra, and Pushpandini, these are devas, but they are not in heaven. They are on earth, and between heaven and hell and earth. That is where they are. They are in the neighborhood. They don't come, they are Vyantaras. And they are not considered to be worshipped for any moksha or anything at all. But there it is, they are like you. They like to be praised, they like to be, you know, awarded this and given this and the devis like the diamonds and that kind of thing. So they do. Perhaps you are going to see some of that, and that's what I thought I should explain to you. And so, see, this is how a Jaina priest in these temples appears. And they are known as Jaina Brahmanas. That's what my topic is, Brahmanization. They are known as Jaina Brahmanas. They do not intermarry with the non-Jaina Brahmanas, other Jains. Other Jains are Sindhika Shravakas. They are not. They have a panoply of the puja inside the shrine room. Outside, of course, as you can see right now. See this gentleman going around? See the shrine? Do you see the table here? With the various pujas somebody has finished. Akshata in the middle and all that. So this is for the man, a man. This is outer hall is for the men. And in this area you will see there is a, up here, there is an image, a photograph of a Muni, Ananta Kirti, who was a Muni, Digambara Muni, from this village, and he went to north and passed away. This outer hall is used for men, and if they want to perform puja, this is how they do that, because inside hall, inside the hall, that is meant for the ladies. This is where the, now we form the shrine itself. On this side is Padmavati Devi, in this side is Saraswati Devi. Basically, Lakshmi and Saraswati. So Lakshmi becomes then Padmavati. Saraswati is worshipped only in Jain temples. Right? And those who know, Mathura has yielded very ancient Saraswati images. They are Jain images. That's something remarkable. One should work, think on that. Otherwise, why should Saraswati be worshipped by Jains and not by... There are no Hindu temples with Saraswati images as such. There may be. It is not obvious. And yet, Saraswati doesn't give you wealth. She may give you some wisdom. But see now, that's Padmavati there, well decorated, and she has also a very colorful sari given. And here is Saraswati, simple, scholarly. But there it is, these are the two worship. On two sides, and Bhagavan Anantanath Tirthankara image is there, and a small image of the same will be put here. And so we move to the next one. This is the bigger image of it. While I am at it, let me just add a few minutes of detail. Yesterday I showed it to Peter. In my childhood, the priest who was there at that time, Chandaya, he had allowed me to have a close look at it, because I was told when I was in college that there are spots of white ant cutting into that whole thing. And the chief priest at that time, who would be my father's age, he told me this is true because we have heard this, and probably the temple is about 300 years old, that this image was once covered by anthill, and that anthill was removed, and then they found this image, and it has got all over except face because it fallen over here. Black and white signs cut into that, and so this is where they built the temple. Now, whether this temple was, there was already a temple and then something happened to it, because otherwise, how can that image, one image, be sitting there doing that? So that's a mystery, but this is a fact that the image, that part of the image shows that it was once upon a time in Antel. Okay. I come to the Brahmadeva, the very famous Yaksha. He is called Yaksha, but actually he is not in the list of the 24 Tirthankara Yakshas other than for Shitarnath, but here it is for Brahmadeva, and this is an additional Yaksha. This was not originally when the temple was done. Sometime, in fact, the entire middle image is there, but the parikara, that is the silver ornamentation of it all, this was added only during this period. So this Brahmadeva is said to be having miraculous powers, and those who have witnessed the puja for that, they can come in front of him, and then the Indra will ask you, will perform arati for him, etc. And he sometimes asks, you know, any particular reason? Then main thing is that you don't have to tell it. God knows what you are doing, kind of thing. And so you just ista prarthana, that's a very set word. Ista prarthana means what? A desired prayer. So and that's it. And it will be fulfilled sometimes. So but this is a miraculous image, and it has been for generation after generation, people have come there just for that. That's why it is called Nellikari, is also called Atishaya. Atishaya is the word that is used for. Atishaya means something excessive, something extra. Okay, now we move from there. You can see now there is I did not see the picture going around the shrine inside and outer wall here. This is a well for temple, and there is a Meru, small Meru. See that? So that is where special puja is done. The Meru is the mountain where Indra takes the body of the in the case the baby Tirthankara, just like you heard about the story of Gautama, Buddha, and so this is used for them. So you can look at the lush greenery of this place, and so this probably brings you to next picture. Welcome home. This is Hademane, old house. This is, well, now your house. Come here, this is my house where I was raised until my father decided to send me away. Only the first front balcony has been added a little later on. But this is, and the name of the house is Halemane, means old house. And it has a Naga Bana attached to it nearby, and Peter went and saw that also. So this is a characteristic village. Now see now, this village has only shakis. 25 houses or 27 houses, one house, first house is this one, upper area, and round off, the last house is of the Indra. That's the Indra's house is hereditary Indrashi. That means his children will become Indras. They have a monopoly of this thing, and they have a land attached to that. They have got they are also the head. Indra will be also a part of the trusteeship. Member of the trustees, and so this is a small village. And now with this, I think I should move further now. What do you think this is?
Rathyatra.
Can you see it?
Yes.
This is the Ratha. And do you know where it is taking place? It's not a Jaina Ratha. This is Rathotsav at the Udupi Sri Krishna temple. This is Udupi coastline. This is where Madhvacharya, the great Madhvacharya, and this is Krishna Mandir Ratha. The tall one, this is the Ratha. Ratha is really up to that area, and then they build it up for decorations, and see just the number of people walking around. And probably these two umbrellas that you see, that one pink and another one, under them there may be some swamis or the heads who have been carried in this crowd, and this is happening, and it happens every year like this. And this is at Udupi. This is, let's say, no more than 40 miles. And this is the model for what you are going to see in Nellikar. That's what I'm saying to you, that this is this particular thing happening here with the ceremonies, with the priesthood, etc. And this is how original Ratha is there, and then you just decorate it. Okay. Now, 1980, this is my town. This is how it was. No car can go there now at that time. And this is the place where we are now going to work on quickly. You see now, the festival begins of Ratha. A priest carrying the Utsava image of a jinnah in procession. This is the Indra who is carrying a standing jinnah of Anantanath, a small Utsava. See, Utsava Murti, that's another Brahmin group. Utsava Murti means the image meant only for such festivals where you can carry it on your head, go around the temple, and then everyone has a darshana. And as you go from house to house, there was a time householders will come with some offerings, each house gets blessing, etc. So this is the beginning of that. And then, see now, this is inside the temple wall, procession is going on. And in my younger days, there was a music going on, musicians going on. Can you see here somebody here? Right here, there is the speaker standing, walking with you, the white hair. And this picture was taken by Arvind, if you remember. And so this will go around the temple walls inside, and see the designs of the temple. Do you think what it is? That's Lokakasha. Lokakasha Siddha Loka. See standing image of Lokakasha with the heaven above and heaven below, etc. And swastikas and all those things are. Next to that there is a, can you see that half moon with a dot on that? That is the Siddha Loka. That is the image. Siddha Loka is like that. And so this is the procession going on, and it's very hot, but we were walking, and just to you recognize that, who I am? Here I am. Okay, and then we move to the next one. Procession continues outside the temple halls now. And procession passes front of the houses. That is the house, older houses. This is not my house, next house is. Okay, then we. Now, the priest carries, one priest carries the image of a new yaksha now. This is something, Sarvana Yaksha, and that is for carrying Dharma Chakra. This Dharma Chakra is in the shape of a round wheel. Buddhists also have Dharma Chakra. In fact, probably Buddhist Dharma Chakra and Jain Dharma Chakra belong to the same Shramana culture. And he is now prepared, and see now that the decorated thing also, he is going to carry the image downstairs, and he will come to the this one. He is approaching the Ratha. And see now the Jaina Ratha. Decorated. Now don't compare with the Udupi thing, but there it is. The Jains are there in sufficient numbers. And that Yaksha carrying person is standing there. And he is waiting for the other image, Anantanath, the Tirthankara image to come, so that he will then lead it to the Ratha where it will be installed. And so probably I don't have pictures of everything, but see now, they come face to face now, these two Indra. He is carrying the image of the Jina, he is carrying the image of Yaksha, and then that is finished, that is why now people come inside, concluding Mangala Arati, that is the auspicious Arati is done. In the festival inside the temple, and he is concluding the stanta. That is the Brahma Deva, that's the Utsava Murti image which was taken down, and this is the some other image similar to that. This is Brahma Deva installed here right in the middle. Can you see that, right? And he's offering flowers, etc. Tirthankar Anantanath is behind. Brahmadeva's image is brought out from that top only on that day, beginning of the Rathotsava, which lasts for 5 days. And then it stays there only for 3 months. And then sometime in end of June, it goes back to the place where it was. And there are many reasons why this is so. We do not get to focus. And these are the people are lined up. The ladies are on two sides of the temple, and they are performing now. This is now attending the festival. Okay, and now we come to this is the invitation sent for the new ratha was made, and this is the now Nancy will give you the papers that you have to read yourself now holding it.
John,
will you pass it on? Oh, here it is. Oh, yeah. I want you to read this yourself. I'm going to run through that. I have, as I said, this is the one opportunity to. These pictures were shown so that you will know what kind of rituals Jains do. These rituals are conducted by Indras who are, you know. See now, I'm just drawing your attention to. Now we can have light. This light here also. Okay. We don't need to, okay, you can want to, for this one you can keep. See now, I'm holding together and read, this is 2 pages, quickly I'm going to read for this. This is the part of education. See, and there will be Kannada words just at the end, but it's almost a Sanskrit. See now, dharmika, vidhi, vidhana, gadu, that will be Kannada, plural. Ravivara, it begins on 4th, March 6th. And then see now, 9:30 a.m. Indra Pratishthe, Vimana Shuddhi, Yaksha Pratishtha, Ratre Shri Balividhan, then Shanivar, Somvar, Kshetrapala Aradhana, then Mangalavar. Of course, everything is there. You should take home and read it. Maha Naivedya Puja. Now, what is that Maha Naivedya Puja would be? I don't know, but there. I'm showing you how these rituals or offerings unknown to the Jains outside this area. How the Jains here perform, and my suggestion is that, as you will see, that the appointment of the Brahmin people, Indras, monopolizing in this, and establishment of a hereditary group of temple priests has meant that there are certain rituals which are not known to others. Let me read a few more. Vastu Vidhan, Navagraha, Shanti Puja, etc. Then we come to Guruvara, which is the main Rathotsava day. See now what happened now. First it says there, Anantanatha Swami Sannidhi. Then Sri Brahma Yaksha, Yantraradhane, Panchamrita Abhishek, etc. Kalyana Mandira, Maha Mangalarati, and Sanjay means in the evening, Gandhi, 4 o'clock, what happened then? Shri Pitha Yantra Aradhana. Now, Shri Pitha Yantra Aradhana also is something worth comparing with the Shri Yantra the Brahmins have. And then from there we move to, it says there, Swami Ayvatnagu Kalasha, 54 Kalasha Abhishek. Then comes important work, Ashwatha Katya Puja. At the beginning, as you enter the town, there is a field through which you saw at the end of the field, that's the beginning of the village, there is an Ashwatha tree, Bodh tree under which Buddha sat, that's the kind of tree. And that tree also has a place in the ritual. The Jina image will be brought there and will be placed, and arati will be made, and some flowers and such. But it's not only the Jina puja, it's Jina puja under the Ashwatha. That also is not, Ashwatha puja also goes with that. Idea that there is some tree god sitting there, no, that kind of thing. But look at that. And then Ashwatha Puja, then comes Aramana Katya Puja, Dvaja Mara, that's the tree which has got the giant of flag upon top, that's the Puja. Then Shukravara, that's the last day. The Rathotsava, what the pictures I showed you now, the Yandra Gindra going around the temple, coming down, etc., that happens, and then the taking the image upon the Ratha, that takes place on this day. What happens here? This one we will read. Rathotsava, etc. Anantanatha Swami, then Sri Chandranatha Swami, Kshira Abhishekana. These are called. The Kshira means water, Kshira also means milk. And so it is said that beginning when the baby is born, Jina, it's taken to the Meru, and there it is given consecration with waters from oceans. There is no milk ocean, but it's called milk ocean, and the water that is called milk there. So they have got similarly Ganga ocean also, and so Ganga also, sandalwood paste also will be used to solve. So all these are variously done, and then comes Panchavrata Abhishek, etc. And again, Balividhana, Ratha Samprokshana, Laksha Huvina Puja, who means flowers. The flowers, Laksha flowers are used for puja. Then comes Ratha Arohanate, in order to take the image up on the Ratha, that is for the Ratha festival. They have accept permission from Brahmadeva, because Brahmadeva is the chief of that temple protector. And see the word used there, Prasada Bedike. Bedike means begging. They ask prasada of this, permission from this, blessings from this Brahmadeva, and that is the time when miraculously some flowers will be given from the image, fall down from that image, that is. Then various things are Vedike, Maha, again Naivedya Puja, then Maha Mangala Arati, then Sri Sarvana Yaksha Sri Gahara, that is the use of Yaksha coming down with the Dharma Chakra. Then there is also Rama Bali, then Madhyanam, and the afternoon what happens? Brahmadeva Darshanam. Then people come to have the darshan of Brahmadeva also, that's a special one. And Anantanatha Swami Ratha, etc. So this is the end of that. And this way, on the Shanivara also there is Visarjane. Kankana Visarjane means what? The conclusion of this whole thing. So I want the Jaina students and scholars to ponder over now, where do these rituals come from? What kind of mantras are used? Jainism is not something that once made and said like that. It will not change continuously, both ritually as well as philosophically in a way, and so on and so forth. So my only here this has remained now. It may have been in the surrounding areas of Karnataka, right up to Belgaum, right up to Kollapur even, but only here this has now survived. And so I have the privilege of seeing. Now, if you open the page, you are on a meeting now. Why are they called Indras? Now I'm going to read Sanskrit for you. See how it is. This is chanting. I think he is working on Abhishek or something in the text of it. So, see now. Whenever a Shravaka or Shravika, they sit for at home or in the temple, perform the same pouring water on a small image, this is what they say. Sriman Mandara Mastake, means on top of the Mandara platform of the Meru Parvata, Meru, Shuchi Jalair, Dhautai, Sadadbhakshatai, with waters, pure water. Pithe, Muktivaram, Nidhaya Rachitam, Tatpada Padma Shrajaha. See now, Indro Aham, the person who performs this says, I am Indra. Indro Aham, Nija Bhushanartha Mamalam, Yajnopavitam Dadhe, and he wears the sacred thread, Yajnopavita, that's what the Brahmins do. But Digambaras only in this place, or South India, have sacred thread. In North India, even the Digambaras don't have sacred thread, Shvetambaras don't have sacred thread. So this is something, again, I'm using the Indra word, Yajnopavitam Dadhe, Mudra, and other ornaments, Mudra, Kankana, Shekhara, Nathata, when Janmabhisheka was surveyed. At the time of Janmabhisheka. And so, the present day, now I must say that this particular Jaina Brahman group, Indras, they have produced many scholars, many poets. At present, the Bhattaraka, the Shravanavelugula temple, comes from this family of the Indras. And Vidyananda Muni, Digambara Muni, who is now in the Delhi, where walked all over India and now settled in Delhi. He also comes from the same similar ground. Now we say, when is this possible? When did this happen? That the Jains have a hereditary household attached to the temple who look like Brahmins, act like Brahmins, and they are treated like Brahmins because the Jains will not marry with them. They are not marrying with the non-Jain Brahmins at all. But what I am saying is that there is we have to find out, is it a possibility that once upon a time, around this same period of 1400, 1500, something like that, or even earlier, when the Jains were ruling in different parts of South India, that Jaina princes or people might have asked the Jaina Brahmins, no, non-Jaina Brahmins, but Brahmins, to become Jaina Brahmins. And so, for this, I am going to help you to read something here by the famous writer T.B. Desai, has Jainism in South India. Now I am going to read Sina. This is inscriptional from the translation from the in South Indian epigraphy, and this is his translation. At Amarapuram in Karnataka in the year 1278 came into being a magnificent temple dedicated to God Prasanna Parshvadeva, which was named Brahma Jinalaya. Mark the word Brahma Jinalaya. Balendu Maladhari Deva. See, now this is another South Indian monk, a Digambara monk, is called Maladhari, which was considered mostly titled for clothed monks whose clothes are tattered, etc. But how the South Indians also have this word is worth pondering about. Kunda Kundanamaya was responsible for the creation of this holy structure. This is the Muni, who inspires people to build this temple. Actually, this is not a building, this is a Jirnodhar, this is a renovation and a new thing, that's all. And so what happens here now? I have cut down a whole lot of material here for the sake of time. Then what happened? Kundakundanamaya was responsible for the creation of this holy structure. Malli Setti, a rich man, made a gift for the temple of God, 2,000 trees, land with 2,000 trees of areca nuts and coconuts, etc. is mentioned there in that. And so, and whatever income that will come from that for the temple, the income derived from the gift was to be used for constructing the Jaina temple with stone from the foundation to the pinnacle, with the Mahamandapa, Bhadra Mandapa, Lakshmi Mandapa, Gopura, Manastambha. The gift was received by Markavar. Received by whom? By the temple priest, already existing temple priest, Chellapille, is a Tamil, who hailed from the Bhuvalokanath Nallur in the southern Pandya country. That means Pandya country where Madura is now. So he is a Tamil Brahmin, apparently. He was a Jina Brahmana, that's the first time you get in the inscription name, Jaina Brahmana, Jina Brahmana, characteristic, not the Vedic Brahmana, Jina Brahmana of Yajurveda. See now, how these are the experts in the Vedic Yajurveda, Aitareya Shakha, Vishu, Vasishta Gotra, and Pravar, Kaundinya, Maitravarna, Yashishta, etc., etc. This shows that there was a group of Brahmins, well-read Brahmins, well-established Vedic Brahmins, who were able to be brought into the Jaina fold and given them the charge of the temples, and then they would devise, and yet they remain Jain. They performed the Jaina things. They did not introduce any non-Jain images or anything at all in that case. This is something, at this time, and this is important, at this time the region was under a Jaina sympathizer, Nolamba Pallava chief Iringula II, who was a patron and follower of the Jaina religion. That also shows that you have got, on the one hand, you have got the royal support, and then the Brahmin, that's just worth thinking about. The Brahmin doesn't easily change his religion or his faith or undertake, okay, if you give money, I'll perform puja for you in your temple. It doesn't happen. So, Now I want to therefore ask you a question. Is it possible that Brahmins, for reasons we don't know, were so enamored, impressed by Jainism, that they decided to become Jains? We have got here two famous literary evidence which I'm quoting. I can't ask you to read Kannada, but see all the Brahmins here, but see here now. Two poets, a very famous one. Both South Indian is Maharashtrian one, and second one, Maharashtrian settled in Karnataka area, and second one, South Indian Brahmin family accepting Jaina faith. Let us quickly read this, the time is coming up. Mahakavi Pushpadanta, and in his Harivamsa Purana, he says the following, and this is his time is given, 965 Samtikaran, during Rashtrakuta thing. Which the, and he was in Manyakheda, Malkhed, yes, it called it. It was destroyed also in that time. In his Prashasti, he says the following. See now, Pushpadanta says, Shiva Bhaktaimi Jinasasane, Shiva Bhaktas were my parents. Jinasasane vi Mayaim Duryaninasan. They died in Jinasasana. Although they Shiva Bhakta means they had accepted Jaina way of Sallekhana, that's what he says. Bambhanayin, they were Brahmins. Keshav Rishi Gotrayin, Kashyap Rishi Gotra. Guru Vayanamiya Puriya Sottayin, Guru Vachanamrita, he said, Digambara Guru, in the commentary itself. And then, the name of the father and mother, Muddha Devi Keshav Ramayin, these are the parents' name he gives. Mahukiyariyam Rayim Khuvantu Sundar. He says that these are my parents, they died Jaina way, and he himself says Mannakheda Pura, Mannakheda is Manyakheda Malkhed, and Nivasante, etc., etc. Kuppayanta is Pushpadanta, his real name is Khanda, Khandoba, Khanda. Is it Khanda means Skanda? And Jinapaya Pankaya Mahulya Hatte, he says, I am always holding my hands in greeting to the Jina Pada. See, thinking here is that here is a great poet whose parents are Shaivites and yet they become Jain. My research object is, why do you think that non-Jains are attracted to Jainism, giving up their God and so on and so forth? Why do they do that? We don't know. And this is not a miracle happening that somebody was bitten by a snake and somebody came and cured, that kind of story. Now quickly move now, the 10th century, Karnada Adi Kavi Pampa, this is another one. Pampa is the name of, that's probably pseudonym, but he is also a non-Jaina Brahmin, and he is the Adi Kavi for Karnada. And see now, he has written this following genealogy of his, when he is right, he wrote two great works. One is Jaina Mahabharata, and another is Jaina Adi Purana in Kannada. And this is, and his date is around 10th century, something like that. See now, how it begins now. What kind of a Brahmins these are? Madhava Somayaji. See now, among the Brahmins, one who performed the Somayajna. Somayaji is considered the supreme Brahmin. After, okay, I have got 5 more minutes to ask you. Okay. Madhava Somayaji, Kannada Brahmin, etc., etc. And you can read this whole thing. I have got little time. Then comes Siddhasena Divakara. Now I ask a question. So in other words, Pampa becomes Brahmin. Pampa's parents become Jaina. So he says. Now I should tell them, the non-Jains who become Jaina, they have performed certain things. They are extremely revolutionary. They will introduce things which ordinary Jains do. For example, here is the story of Siddhasena Divakara. I think Siddhasena Divakara has been written about by many people, including I think Phyllis here. See now, what was he? He was a Brahmin, but he becomes a Jaina monk. But then what he says, I have highlighted that. Siddhantam, so you say, Abhalya, fourth line, from the childhood, Abhalya. Samskritabhyasi, because he has done Sanskrit learning. Karma doshat, Forrester no Siddhantam Sanskritam Kartum Ichchan. He wanted to turn the entire practical literature of Alamas into Sanskrit. And then Sangam Vijnapad, he said, let me persuade. And then the Sangha said, this is a great grave offense. And therefore he was given Paranchika means he has to be this and that. I am simply showing you some modern examples of non-Jains becoming ascetics, etc. I have got here that how Atmaramji Maharaj, who was born at Brahma Kshatra, and I believe not Jain as far as I think so, he becomes a Sthanakvasi Muni, then he becomes a Sri Kamara Murti Pujar Muni. Ganesh Prasadji, the famous one, he was also a Vaishnava and then he becomes a Jain and then he establishes at the Mahavidyalaya. I am on the last page quickly. And then what happens? Sthanakvasi Muni, Sushil Kumar Muni, who had come here, if you know, he was 10 years old and a Brahmin god. He was picked up and made, and then by the people in the Virayatana, which is in the Rajagriha area of Patna. And Virayatana is also run by Sthanakvasi group, who are revolutionaries inspired by the Brahmins. Near Rajagriha, Muni Sushil violated the rules against travel. He came to this country, said, although I am a Muni, I can travel. Visited USA to attend the meeting of the world and establish the Jaina center at Siddhachalam. You all know about that. Similar, but then Virayatana modified several rules, notably for travel for the ascetics, that they can travel without any problem, even in India, without giving up the traditional designations of Muni or Sadhvi. The Virayatana group even honors Sadhvi Chandana as an Acharya, which is a rare thing to happen, never has happened, only Munis are. There I am on the last one. From Sthanakvasi to Digambara. What is something happening here? That Shvetabhara to Digambara happening now. That is something see now. Shvetabhara Murti Pujaka Srimaliya, you have already heard from Bhandandas how Banaras Das was a Srimali. Shvetabhara Murti Pujaka, how he, under the influence of Kundukunda, Samayasara, etc., he accepts Jaina Adhyatma and two great Megha Vijaya, about whom Paul said, and Yasho Vijaya have written works against this new Digambaras, Nava Digambaras. And then Srimad Raichandai Mehta, that is Srimad Raichand, whose grandfather was a great Vaishnava. He says that he had continued until age of 10, his Srimad himself. And then after reading Samayasara and Shamsapur, he became impressed by the Adhyatma of that. And even he never mentions that he has read deeply the Shvetambara Agama. He may have quoted here and there some Uttaradhyayana or something like that, other than that he has not. And here, then the Sthanakvasi Muni, I think his name is Raghuraj Swami, and several others, they think they considering his guru and accepted the Digambara Pinchi also, this one particular whose picture appears in the temple in Milpitas as a Digambara thing. Now I am on the last one. Kanji Swami, another Sthanakvasi. A Sthanakvasi Muni from 1913, he is from Saurashtra, I think, somewhere. Influenced by the Samayasara and other works of Kundakunta, Kanji renounced his mendicant vows in 1934. They said, I am no longer a Muni now. Period. And became a Digambara, a layman, saying that I have no vratas anymore. Vratas are all vyavahara kind of thing. Okay. He is the founder of the Kanji Panth. Many Sthanakvasis, as well as the Digambara laymen, have accepted his teachings, rejecting, and that's the important part, rejecting the spiritual status and authority of both the Shvetambara and Digambara ascetics. Now, that's a very revolutionary thing, and I think our research should be now, why are Digambara, Samayasara, Savachana so influential? Why are the Sthanakvasis and the Shvetambaras turning to Digambara thing? Is there something missing in the Shvetambara that Kundakunda provides? Or is it because there is no other reason to think of? It's not money, it is not status, it is not any special honor or anything at all. Very important thing, because as everyone knows, Kanji Panth is a modern development and it's going to have a long effect on that. If indeed the Munis are rejected, then where does Jainism stand? That is something. And no temple, no guru, Shastra only, Samayasara. is this what Jainism is going to be. Finally, let me just end this one. I have been talking about Brahmins and Jainas, Shramanas. Shramana Brahmana. Originally, Shramana Brahmana were considered enemies of each other. After reading this, go to the last paragraph, last one. Desham virudha shashvatikah desham dvandve ekavachanameva. Those whose hostility is eternal, shashvatikah. Like what? Kaka ulukam, crow and owl, snake and mongoose. It is not, I have not given the whole thing here. But the first one to appear in Patanjali is Shramana Brahmanam. Shramana and Brahmana are said to be those who has shashvatika virodha, difference eternal. I am going to ask you one thing. No one has ever said, dare to say, that you could change Paninian rules or Patanjali's Vashya. After seeing how the Shramana and Brahmana have come together, don't you think the shashvatika is a bit too much? Thank you very, very much.